Ladies and gentlemen, hello. In this episode, I wanted to discuss two important topics: data-driven decision making and the hierarchy of evidence. Before, let's recall something from the movies. In cinema films, the phrase "show me money" or "pay me" is often used to emphasize the importance of money in certain situations. So in this case, the actor will say, "You want to do this? Show me money. You want to do that? Show me money. You don't want to do anything? Show me money." It's all about money. If you want a simple understanding of data-driven decision-making, you can apply the same concept. But of course, instead of money, put data. If you want to do this, show me data. If you want to do that, show me data. If you don't want to do anything, show me data. It's all about data. If we apply this on healthcare, if you wanted to adopt a strategy to improve the healthcare outcomes, show me data. If you want me to approve certain policy in healthcare, show me data. If you wanted to have a clinical decision for one patient, show me data. And in the business and in the industry, let's take the pharmaceutical industry as an example. You wanted to do something, show me data. You wanted me to approve a project, show me data. You want us to endorse a strategy, show me data. You want to hire someone, show me data. You want to fire someone, show me data. You don't want to do anything, show me data. That means data is needed whenever we think and do anything, because we need our decision-making process and initiatives to be well-rooted in data. And what is data? Data is evidence. So we want our decision-making and our strategies to be well-rooted in evidence. And data is the way to do this. So this is the concept of data-driven decision-making. And it simply emphasizes the importance of referring our claims, our strategies, our requests to data, in order to give the decision maker the comfortability and the assurance that their decision will be well informed. And being well informed is being more strategic. And that has gained a lot of attention nowadays, because really, data-driven decision making is the way to go when it comes to strategic thinking and planning. So, if we understand this concept, and let me here shift the gears and talk about evidence-based medicine, we in medical affairs understand very well the terminology, and we understand the concept of evidence-based medicine. The evidence-based medicine is the most judicious use of available clinical evidence for the best benefit of patients. And it has three main components. They call it the evidence-based trait. And here it is the first, which is the clinical expertise of the healthcare professional. Number two is the clinical evidence available data. And the third is the patient preferences. So these are the three main components of evidence-based medicine. It targets one objective. We need to take decisions that are well-rooted with evidence or in evidence in order to improve the patient outcomes or the treatment outcomes. When we recall the concept of evidence-based medicine, I found myself forced to consider the concept of data-driven decision-making, because if we think of evidence-based medicine when it comes to patient treatments and strategies, this is the same concept that we apply outside the healthcare context in business, data-driven decision-making. So in clinical practice, we need our decisions to be based on clinical evidence. And in the industry or in the business, we need our decision to be based on different data, whether they are market research data, whether they are observed trends and well-criticized trends, and verified data from different sources or from feedback. We need to base our decision on this. So this is, from my opinion, the link between data-driven decision-making and the evidence-based medicine. But now let's shift the gears and talk about the hierarchy of evidence. As long as we are already discussing evidence-based medicine, I mentioned that the definition is to use the best available evidence in a most judicious way. And here we have to understand that all the data are not at the same level when it comes to credibility. So there are data that are of average credibility and other data that are considered very strong evidence. And of course, when we take clinical decisions in practice, we need always to refer to the highest reliable data and the high quality data. The hierarchy of evidence is usually visualized in the form of pyramid. And going from the base to the top, you are going from the lowest to the highest degree of credibility and evidence. At the bottom of the pyramid, there are expert opinions and information shared. So you can read an expert opinion in the newspaper, you can read it in a textbook, but they don't have any data. They are based on subjective judgment. And that's why some journals, they don't accept publishing expert opinions as an individual article nowadays. They lack substantiated evidence. And this is at the base of the pyramid. If we go one step up, we go to case reports or case control studies. And in case reports, there are patients with documented signs and symptoms. All the interventions were documented, and this can be published as a case study. This is some sort of evidence, but of course it lacks the applicability on a wider scale or a population. So it is considered an average level of evidence. It's not the strongest and it's not the weakest. We move one step up to the cohort studies. And once again, it's not the highest cohort study, it's not the lowest. It's in the middle. It lacks also applicability because the concept was not tested or applicable across different populations. But the next step is the randomized control trials. And the randomized control trials is the level that is considered the gold standard in medical research. Randomized controlled studies are the highest level of evidence, and they come at the top of, or they sit at the top of the pyramid. The only thing that can exceed the strength of the randomized controlled trial is a meta-analysis or a systematic review that are built from randomized controlled trials and have been critically appraised. Each study of this has been critically appraised to address one concept or one research question. So going from expert opinions up the pyramid to randomized controlled trials, and finally the systematic reviews. When you get into a situation where you are discussing a clinical decision with your physician or your key opinion leader, you have to remember this pyramid, the hierarchy of evidence, because based on this evidence, you need to have or to conduct the discussion with your physician. You cannot build an argument with your key opinion leader if he's talking about phase 2 and phase 3 clinical trials, for example, and you are referring to a cohort study or an open label study. So we need to be very mindful when we use the hierarchy of evidence in order to be relevant to the scientific information and to evidence-based medicine. Thank you very much. It was a short episode, and looking forward to meeting you soon. Bye.